Friends, dear colleagues, Madam Ambassador, Excellencies, my name is Ivan Baba. I'm the Deputy Director of this Institute, and now I will be the chair of this panel this morning and the panel we are having after the lunch. Let me introduce the two panelists. Madam Magdalena Vašáriová from Slovakia. Mrs. Vašáriová is the former ambassador of Czechoslovakia to Vienna, Austria, of Slovakia, Warsaw, Poland, and deputy minister of foreign affairs, or state secretary of foreign affairs. Mrs. Boglárka Koller is the dean of the Faculty of International and European Studies of the National University of Public Administration and the head of the Department of European Studies. So the two panelists will continue. Discussing the main topics, main issues of the first panel, namely Central Europe and the European Union, V4, pros and cons, successes and conflicts, and so on. So that first, Boglárka Koller will offer you a presentation on Visegrád and the advantages, disadvantages, and so on. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I also welcome you warmly. And I was listening to the previous panel with curiosity because and I can link very easily to my presentation because the concepts and the topics and the questions you raised exactly the same what I ask, and so now I have an easy task, because my question is what we can conclude is that the Visegrad Group is a strange animal in European politics, policy making, and also in the European polity. And what I prepared for today is a kind of theoretical and conceptual thing. So hopefully after my presentation we can ask better the question, what is this Visegrad Group in the European Union at the moment? So my question is, and you raised the last question, but you, I don't know, somebody who was sitting there close to the head of the Hungarian representation of the European Commission was about the multi-speed Europe, and also raised the issue of differentiated integration. And exactly this is the question what I asked, is that the Visegrad Group as a new, can we consider it as a new emerging form of differentiated integration in Europe? So this is going to be the main question I ask, and my background, I'm a political scientist and I'm dealing with European integration, so maybe you will find my presentation useful and also interesting for all of the students who would like to analyze Visegrad cooperation more deeply. So what is this V4? What kind of actor, political actor, can we also call it as such? So the Visegrad dimension, and you know all this story, and I'm not going to discuss it because that would take a lot of time. But even the birth of the Visegrad cooperation is debated. So who invented this? Of course, the Hungarians claim that we invented this cooperation. But the Czechs think that it was Václav Havel's idea. So even there is a debate who was the first founding nation of this cooperation. But one thing is sure, that we cannot interpret Visegrad cooperation without understanding the European integration. So when it was born, it was born together with the motivation of the Central and Eastern European states to get closer to Europe. So there is an important moment, however, is the relaunch of the Visegrad cooperation at the end of the last century, when the whole cooperation was reformed and gained new interpretation. And of course, and I put into this timeline always the events of the enlargement process, because I argue that at the beginning of the Visegrad cooperation, it has to be interpreted together with the European integration. It cannot be put aside. And it's a very important argument, because nowadays, and even if you look at yesterday's miniature meeting in Brussels, which is an informal meeting, was organized, called together by the President of the European Commission. And as you know, the Visegrad countries did not participate at this event. Now we, at the moment, try to look at this Visegrad animal as something which do not belong to this European common table. However, what I claim is when it was launched, it was launched along the European enlargement process, and also afterwards we can also interpret it as part of the Europeanization process. So Visegrad cooperation was born at the beginning of the EU enlargement process of Hungary, relaunched in 1990, as I said, but only became an essential framework of regional cooperation in the post-enlargement period. What does that mean, post-enlargement period? So after 2004. So I really argue that the analysis of V4 cannot be detached from the understanding of the effects of EU membership. However, and this is the theoretical framework what I will present, as time went by, these countries, the Central and Eastern European countries, and in particular the V4 countries, started to be more away from the accession-related constraints, so the conditionality in the enlargement process. So as time went by, they really started to express their own national agenda in relation to the EU as well, and started to use V4 as a new platform, as my previous colleague just called it, to express the national interest more intensively. We are in the Europeanization literature, so if you study the European integration, you know this literature very well. What does it mean? And I'm not going to call all of the authors, because I don't want to bore you. But I think Europeanization literature can be also applied very well to understand what is this strange animal V4 in the European integration. As you know, and if you may be familiar with these authors, Europeanization refers to the process and outcomes by which the institutional logic, the norms, the political discourse became European alike. So if a country would like to join the European Union, then according to these theories, they have to adapt to the norms, the way of thinking, the institutions, and also to the politics of the European Union. Enlargement process is a process where this kind of Europeanization can be pushed very actively by the European institutions. Why? Because if countries do not meet the conditions, the conditionality, according to the conditionality principle, they will not join the EU. So at that part, so when they are in the process of enlargement, they adapt to these norms very eagerly. And if you go back to and study the Eastern enlargement process, which was a very, very long process, it took 15 years, then you can see that at the beginning, these countries never asked, never questioned these kind of conditions that came from the European Union. However, there are a lot of the strategy was not clear what came from the European Commission many times, but these countries never questioned this. So back to Europe narrative was not questioned by the foreign policy of the V4 countries. But as you see in this little picture and visual on your right, nowadays Europeanization has to be interpreted in another manner. because formally we use Europeanization concept as a top-down process, so norms and the European institutions and form of the European Commission said what you have to do in country reports, that you have to reform in these policy areas, you have to do this and that. But nowadays the literature also changed the angle, and they are claiming that Europeanization has to be understood in a much broader sense. So it can also mean that the newcomers who came, who became members in the European Union, they can also upload their ideas and their policy-making initiatives to the European level. So it is not anymore just a top-down process, but they also upload policy. They also can initiate lawmaking processes, and they can also launch policies, or they can even question the formerly unquestioned goals and laws of the European Union, which means that nowadays Europeanization has to be understood not only as a top-down process, but also as a bottom-up approach. And this will have a special importance in understanding what we can define under the term of V4 and how V4 is operating at the European scene. So how I see this whole thing is the post-enlargement, I mean the post 2004 period. I understand it, I concentrate in my analysis on the Big Bang enlargement wave. So this post-enlargement thing is a very interesting period to analyze, because if we analyze from year to year each Hungarian government, for example, what was the attitude to European integration and also in the policy-making processes, we can find the moments where Hungary said and started to criticize. I think it's a natural process. So if a country becomes a new member, when the enlargement process is finished, so we are a member, we are very happy that we are a member of the European Union, then afterwards, taking a seat at the common table of Europe, we start to criticize. We learn the process, how Europe works, but we also start to elevate the accession-related constraints. So we are not anymore in the situation in the enlargement, so we can also criticize and emancipate ourselves from following the top-down processes of Europeanization, and also try to come up with our own idea. I don't think it's a wrong thing. It happened with all the other member states as well. So the question marks appeared on the scene when they became members of the European community. So we have to understand it more as an EU level system of interaction, and it's not a strange thing. However, here we have to also mention that the European integration, and you may also know this from the literature, from Robert Putnam, who interpreted the international politics as a two-level game. What does that mean? It means that the domestic politicians are playing, and it can be applied for the EU, that the domestic politicians are playing a two-level game. So, and it was also mentioned several times in the previous panel that they have a very different communication when they are in the European Parliament. If they come home, they are formulating very different images in order to convince their voters, because the politicians, what they want is just to maximize their power and also maximize the votes. So what does that mean? That each political leader appears at both game board. They act according to the pressure coming from the domestic groups in order to maximize their power, and also at international level they act in order to able to satisfy domestic pressures. So when they come home, they would like to minimize the adverse consequences of foreign developments. So it's like a double stage, and it's not a new literature, because it was put on the table in the 80s. But I think we can also upgrade this kind of theory and use this two-level game approach. And in case of Visegrad, we can talk about the three-level game approach that the politicians are playing, which means that Visegrad group is the third level, where a platform, the previous panel called it, is that The first level indicates the member state level, the second, the B4 interaction, but the most important is the EU level. So in line with the Putnam's approach, we can also view that the Visegrad politics has had, at the moment, three stages to play their performance. But then we can ask, what kind of level is this V4 among these three? And I try to provide you an answer, because it's not the same. It's a non-institutionalized club. It has to be very much stressed. So it's not like the European Union, which is neither a state nor an international organization. It's a hybrid, sui generis political community. The V4 intentionally kept the character of non-institutionalized form. And there is the domestic politics, where they are playing the games of the competition for maximizing their power and also gaining the votes of the citizens. So it's a very, I also created a visual. It was not easy to find a visual, but imagine a kind of table like this. That this is the member state politics. This is this is an intelligent. So this is the member state politic level. This is the V4, and this is the EU level. So what? And according to my theoretical interpretation, the V4 is a kind of platform where the domestic politicians are jumping if they think that it meets their national interest, they can use it. If it doesn't, then they don't care about V4, they jump immediately to this third level, to the EU level, and they express their elements. So it's a rather, so if we talk about V4, it's not just a two-level game for the Central and Eastern European politicians for these four countries, but it can be maybe later V4 plus. But also we have this other table, which can be very, very useful for expressing the national interest. I don't want to bore you more with theoretical things, but I have also so my theoretical model about this. But it's not only mine, because I have a co-author, Cristina Arato, who is also active in it. So we wrote an article about it, and that was just published. So I will come here. So it's what is this? It's the timeline of this post-enlargement period, but also not just post-enlargement starts here, but before that we can talk about the enlargement process. So as the enlargement process starts, the V4 countries and also all the Central and Eastern Europeans, they really are in adapting all the norms and the institutional things that are coming as a top-down process from the European institutions. As time goes by, and these are important timelines we can also analyze more deeply. This kind of thing, the top-down process, and then they become members, the bottom-up thing is also comes into the question, and they try to express, and they start to express more their national interest. What is here? This is also very important in this theoretical model, because this whole Europeanization thing affects three angles of politics. It affects the politics, which is high politics, the power politics. It affects polity, which includes the institutional system and also the norms. Identity, which is very important. I will also touch upon this very shortly at the end of my presentation. And policy issues. So if we talk about Europeanization, it's all these three nodes. And it's too intelligent. The whole migration crisis can be put into this theoretical model. Why? Because the migration crisis is a policy crisis, but we all know that it's not only a policy crisis, so it's at the high politics of the V4 thing. And if you imagine this three-level game approach, you can see what kind of games the domestic politicians are playing at each level of this table. So from a policy crisis, a politics crisis appears, and we can also include the polity and the institutional side of it. So So I think it applying all the theoretical knowledge that we have through Europeanization, we can create this kind of model, which rather describes that nowadays, if you look at the situation in the EU, it's more like we can expect that these different countries are going to play the game of more bottom-up Europeanization, so that they are going to come up with ideas and also agenda, they are going to become agenda setters at the European level. So they, other European member states can also expect that the different countries are going to express their ideas more often and more intensively in the future. So the bottom-up angle of Europeanization is going to be strengthened. Other things? Question. Okay, if you know this, and that can be debated because that's a personal view. What is this? Yeah, so it describes the status of the EU at the moment very, very nicely, because it makes you cry if you cook. It has layers, so it also depicts and also can be visualized the crisis situation of the European integration at the moment. But it's good for us to interpret the V4 as well. Why? Because the European integration and it has a huge literature as well, so if somebody is interested in that, because that's my core area of research, I can give you a lot of things. But briefly, we can say that Europe unified integration model, how the European integration started with six member states and as a really unified integration model. However, I have to say that differentiated integration and reference to DEI was present in the Rome Treaty as well, so it's not a new thing. But as the integration became more deepened and more countries joined the EC or the EU, it turns towards a differentiated integration model. What does that mean? That there are countries, group of countries, which are eager to participate in deeper integration circles, and others who just stay at an outer layer of the onion, so they are not part of this integration. Eurozone, Schengen, all examples for that kind of integration. But it has a lot of threats. Why? The most important threat is the identity threat. Because while formerly it was easily to define to which club I belong to, and I have a very nice quote from Woody Allen, who said that I never want to belong to a club which accepts me as a member. And that really depicts the situation very nicely in the EU. Which means that nowadays is not the question is not just that which club, because EU membership represents only one club in the European integration model, because there are other kind of clubs and communities. What does it mean? And it was mentioned, and I'm very happy that it came up with the question, with the previous questions of the panel. So this is my kind of model, and this is what the European institutions promote. This is the multi-speed Europe. Everybody wants to have this kind of car, but maybe they only have this. So it means that doesn't matter which kind of car we have, we can get from A to B, but not at the same speed. That's the most important thing. And the monetary, economic and monetary union, according to the treaties, and also which is communicated by the European Commission as well, is this kind of model. Everybody can get from A to B. It's of course, there are, we can go more in details in this, but not everybody with the same speed. So it also requires a kind of openness. So multi-speed means that everybody can join. Those who are better or better prepared can choose this car. And all the others can follow with a not so fast car. So second type of DEI, differentiated integration, is the so-called variable geometry. What does that mean? If you would like to put V4 somewhere, we can put more into this, because it has certain geographical factors also involved in the concept. It reflects spatial differences of EU policies, and the participation in certain policies are can lead to more irreparable separation, long-term separation. I don't have time more. Long-term separation.
Choose the second year.
Okay.
I am happy because I have.
Speed up a little bit, yeah.
Okay. So Schengen is something like that. And a la carte, and it's not a coincidence that it's David Cameron, so they put it on the table. So it's a kind of European integration model, which is part of DEI, which means that I pick and choose from the achievements of European integration. I like this one, but I don't like the spinach, so I don't want to take it. No, I'm just making a joke now, but of course, this is what was really promoted by UK and Denmark in the Economic and Monetary Union, but we can name other examples as well. So what where we are is differentiated integration can be understood according to the current literature in a more wider sense, even a wider sense, which means that we can understand under DEI as a phenomenon that changes the underlying logic of European integration, since it reinterprets the meaning of EU membership, the relationship between member states and non-members, and thus also gives new interpretation for the future of the EU. Why is it interesting for us? It's because if we interpret differentiated integration in a wider term, then we can also interpret V4 as a kind of differentiated integration, because partly we can find traits of V4 which can be put into this logic. But it has to be also mentioned that it's a loose, non-institutionalized form of cooperation. It's a very important thing. So maybe V4 is not a type of DEI. It's not an EU treaty-based enhanced cooperation, but an intergovernmental group. And there are clear divisions among the members, the V4 members, in many respects, and all of them were mentioned in the previous panel: foreign policy towards Russia, Ukraine crisis, the Eurozone membership, etc., and also policy areas and other politics aspects also differentiate the members. About the identity, the V4 has a fuzzy identity. V4 is considered as a group of laggards by the EU member states, but they consider themselves as a group of pioneers. So it's a clash between how they define. It's very important how there's the self-definition, but the other definition is also very important. But it can be, we can also argue that it can be considered as a mixture of differentiated integration. Why? It is a kind of variable geometry. It clearly reflects a form of spatial difference. Participation is not possible for other EU member states, so it's connected to a geographical entity. If we look at the policy area and issue chosen, V4, it's a kind of a la carte type of differentiated integration. V4 can pick and choose among policies. They can never reinterpret the EU achievements. And I think the nicest example of this pick and choose was the interpreting solidarity as flexible solidarity. It's a very nice example because it came from the V4 countries. And if you also analyze the time factor, we can also claim that policy solutions initiated that clearly reject the EU mainstream, but they are not supposed to remain in the outer layer of the European integration. So even if V4 is considered as the outer layer of the onion, they consider themselves as being the core of the European integration. So that's and then the political issue is immediately raised. Last but not least, I would like to mention a softer topic, which discusses the identity aspect of this V4. So it is really a club, so the citizens of the V4 feel themselves as one community within the big European community. If you look at this, you know that if we are forming our identities, it's very important to define who are the others. So we can define ourselves, who I am, then I always put somebody who is the other. So for V4, who are these others? And then we have a lot of questions to raise. Linguistic alliance? No. because the Slavic languages, Hungary is not part of it, for example. The attitude in foreign policy to Russia, for example, is very different. If we just take out Poland and Hungary, we can find points for this argument. Who belongs to core Europe? And then we also heard that Slovakia would like to, Slovakia and Czech Republic expressed many times that more belongs to the core, or we can also name a rivalry between the Slavkov triangle, which was also formed, and the Visegrad club. So we can also put a question mark to this. Eurozone membership is an interesting thing because only Slovakia is part of the Eurozone, not other member states. And the immigration question, that we can state that the B4 has a rather unified opinion in this respect, but there were different attitudes to solving the migration crisis among the countries. So for example, not all the countries followed the pattern of Hungary not having any, so zero number of migrants. Some of the countries, however, that aligned themselves behind the V4, they also started to align themselves to EU as well at the same time. So it was not a unified platform in this respect either. And I have a very good colleague who's coming from, also from Comenius University, yes. Olga Gyárfásova, and I think she has very good results in researching this. So it's Olga's mutual trust analysis, which also gives us a lot of insight if this identity exists. So if the Slovaks, citizens of Czech Republic, so if they feel trust to the other nations, they feel trust to Slovaks, French, English, Poles, Austrians, Germans, American, Hungarians, Slovenians, Russians, Ukrainians, which means that for them, some, of course, Slovaks are close in the mutual trust analysis, but Hungary is only here, so they trust more the Germans than Hungarians. Citizens of Hungary, Germans, much more than the Poles. Germans, Poles, English, Slovaks, and this goes Czechs, Austrians. So, question mark to this common identity. Citizens of Poland, they are the best V4 identity holder citizens, because Slovaks, Czech Republic, Hungarians, Germans, English, and here comes also other CE countries. Citizens of Slovakia, Czechs, of course, that's an expected result. Austrians, Poles, Croatians, Germans. So on the basis of that, we say that the trust is, except of Poland, is not higher in relation to the fellow V4 nationals. And there is another. This one is also very interesting. That's an important survey, that the intensity of mutual contact, that's also a very interesting chart. It's you cannot say that it's more intensive in relation to the other nations than, for example, to the old member state nationals. So to me, it says that there is a long road to take in order to build up this V4 identity. However, in the Hungarian public television, it exists a special edition in the public television, V4 News. But sometimes they are funny because they have not a lot of content. So what we can say here is we can argue that it's a kind of DI in the making, V4, but if you see these topics, we can find common positions, but we can also find a disagreement between the V4 countries. But what is very interesting is this periphery and mainstream question. Because for the V4 countries, they don't consider themselves as periphery. They consider themselves as providing a new Europe or inventing Europe, contributing to invent Europe itself. But if you read the Western literature, and not only scientific but also the press, I know we are living in the fake news period of history, but then if you just look at what kind of concepts are connected to V4, they are rather blaming V4 to contributing to go to bring Europe to the collapse. I will close now. Conclusions. So So there are certain periods in V4 history where we can only interpret V4 along EU membership. That's very important to emphasize. V4 became an important actor in the EU agenda setting, disregard from normative evaluations at both sides, so it's important to that, it, and it will become an important actor in the future. V4, however, is a non-institutionalized and there are a lot of fractions among members, so it's a not a unified community. And the three P's, so policy, politics, and polity, are all can be used to interpret this, and they are interconnected. So if we talk about a policy crisis, it also has a crisis in the high politics as well. V4 is an essential factor of foreign policy of all these member states, and it is to some extent a kind of DI, because we found also argument to this. However, we can also found counter arguments, but if we interpret differentiated integration in a wider sense, then we can put V4 as a new actor at the European political level. And if you would like to read more about it, that's an advertisement. It was just launched. We have a German colleagues and Greek colleague, and they launched a book, Central and Eastern Europe in EU Challenge and Perspective, a draft literature publisher, and we wrote a chapter on this, so it's theoretical explanation of V4. Thank you very much.